Look for just a moment over in Luke chapter 1 once again, and we're talking about Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist. And of course, we find him here in the opening verses of the Gospel of Luke. And we find that when Zechariah went into the temple to offer incense, and it was a high honor because we read from the historical account, at this particular time in the history of Israel, there may have been up to 21,000 priests. And of course, this opportunity was given by the drawing of lots. And so Zechariah was given this particular opportunity. And I believe that God was in the mix of it all, and He arranged it all for Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, to come to the golden altar of incense, where Gabriel, one of the angels of the Lord, could speak to him about the birth of his son and the forerunner, John the Baptist. And so notice with me, if you would, beginning at verse 8 of Luke chapter 1. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And this is an exact replica of the dimensions and how that the ark or the altar of incense would be portrayed from the book of Exodus 25 through the 30th chapters. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zechariah saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. And the angel said unto him, "Fear not, Zechariah, for thy prayer is heard. Thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son. Thou shalt call his name John." And then it goes on that Zechariah says to Gabriel, "I don't know what to say. I don't know how to react to all this." And then Gabriel said, "That's fine. You're not going to be able to talk it all." And so when he came out of the temple, he was making signs with his hands and trying to convey to his wife Elizabeth and all those that waited, and they knew that he had seen a vision because he still had good understanding. But now he is mute. He is unable to speak. And of course, the angel goes on, and listen to what happens in verse 20. "And behold, thou shalt be dumb and not able to speak unto the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season." I want you to write down a second opportunity. On this first opportunity, when he came before the Lord to give praise and to give glory to God, Zechariah blew it. And so many times we're guilty of doing the very same. Think about the opportunity even today to be in the house of the Lord. And sometimes it's just all that is going on around us. And I want you to think about that for a moment. Zechariah, he was a learned man. And the Bible tells us, all the way back to verse 6 of chapter 1 here, that Zechariah and Elizabeth were walking in all the commandments and the ordinances of the Lord. They were righteous and they were both blameless. But yet with all of his vast reservoir of knowledge, when he came into the temple and he got to the golden altar of incense, he failed miserably. I feel that way almost after every sermon that I bring. I say, "Oh Lord, I should have said that differently. It just didn't come out like I thought it would. Lord, the preparation and the prayer and the study that I put into this effort, but it seems like, Lord, it never got off of the launching pad." I say that nearly after every message that I bring. And I promise the Lord that the next time I'm going to do far better. Lord, I'm going to be more prepared. I'm going to have more of it in my mind and in my heart. I'm going to have a better grasp of the truth. And Lord, the next opportunity that you give me to be able to bring the word, I'm going to do a far better job than what I did the last time. Think about Zechariah now. We know at least for these 9 months, he couldn't say anything at all. But he did convey somewhere along the way to Elizabeth, and of course you know how that Mary is going to come and visit Elizabeth after the great Annunciation and the Immaculate Conception, and she's going to be with Elizabeth in the hill country and then back to Nazareth. And you remember that when she gives this greeting to Elizabeth, that John the Baptist begins to move in Elizabeth's womb, and he's ready to get out and become the forerunner, the one that's going to prepare the way before the Lord. All of this is an exciting time because God is preparing the world for the entrance of His only begotten Son. And you can find John prophesied of in Malachi chapter 4 that he's going to be the forerunner, that he's going to go before the face of the Lord, and he's going to be a revivalist. And so in the midst of all that, Zechariah, he can't say anything at all, but you know that he's contemplating in his mind. If I ever get another opportunity to praise God in the very presence of God, I'm going to do a better job than what I did the last time because I doubted Gabriel. And Gabriel had to get pretty curt with me. And Gabriel said, "How do you know this? Here's the way that you know this. I am Gabriel, and I stand in the presence of the Lord. And Zechariah, have you ever seen anyone like me? Have you ever heard anyone like me?" But yet in the midst of all that, Zechariah, he misses the mark. I do the very same, and you do the same also. But 9 months later, when John is born, and they take him to the temple to circumcise him and to register his name as John, all we find now that Zechariah is filled with the Spirit. Look at verse 57 and notice what it says. "Now Elizabeth's full time came that she should be delivered, and she brought forth a son. And her neighbors and her cousins heard how that the Lord had showed great mercy upon her, and they rejoiced with her. And it came to pass that on the eighth day they came to circumcise the child, and they called him Zechariah, after the name of his father. And his mother answered and said, 'Not so.'" Zechariah still couldn't say anything, but somewhere along the way in 9 months, Zechariah told Elizabeth, "Our boy's name is going to be John. There's no doubt about that. That's the name that the angel gave me in verse 13, and I'm going to agree with the angel of God." "And they said unto her, 'There is none of thy kindred that is called by this name.' And they made signs to his father how he would have him called. And he asked for a writing table, and he wrote, saying, 'His name is John.' And they marveled." And when he agreed with God, when he said, "I'm going to call him John, not after myself, not Zach Jr., I'm going to call him John," his mouth was opened. And immediately his tongue was loosed, and he spake and praised God. He said, "I'm going to do it right this time." You know what we do a lot of times in church? We let the formality, we let all that is going on around us rob us of what we ought to give to God when we stand before the golden altar of incense and we know that we've come into His presence to praise Him. Let me see if you can say this with me or whisper it with me if you would. "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before His presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that has made us and not we ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving, into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and His truth endureth to all generations." I know that. That's a part of me. But a lot of times, I don't know why, I get stifled. I don't know what happens to me, but the devil steals my opportunity to praise God. And we know that in the 92nd Psalms at verse 1, the Bible says, "It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord and to sing praises unto His name." How many knows today, even on a cold, snowy, blustery day like we're experiencing this Lord's Day, how many realizes it is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord and to sing praises unto His name? Do you believe today that there is a transforming power in being thankful. Let me show you what made the difference for Zechariah. Listen to what happens in verse 65. And fear came on all that dwelt round about them. And all these sayings were noised abroad throughout all the hill country of Judea. And all they that heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying, what manner of child shall this be? And the hand of the Lord was with him. Here's what makes the difference now. Look at verse 67. And his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Ghost. Let me show you something about being filled with the Holy Ghost. And of course, we find that it's an imperative command in Ephesians chapter 5 at verse 18. Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be ye filled with the Spirit. And we can go on above wine. Don't be filled with pleasure. Don't be filled with worry. Don't be filled with frustration. Don't be filled with anxiety. Don't be self-absorbed and just filled with yourself. Don't just be filled with your family all the time. Don't be filled with your finances. Let me show you something. Whatever fills us is in control of us. And a lot of times, you don't know what a person is full of until they get jostled just a little bit. And then when they get jostled around just a little bit, then it comes out of what they are filled with. I'm telling you, when somebody's carrying something, you may not know what's in the pot. You may not know what the vessel contains, but if you bump up against them or they get jostled a little bit, whatever they are filled with, it's going to spill out. And that's what's happening in our world today. People are filled with anger, and people are filled with frustration, and they're filled with doubt, and they're filled with worry. And most people are just filled up with themselves. As my mother used to say, most folks can walk down Lover's Lane by themselves and never feel lonely because they love themselves so much and were self-absorbed. And so Zechariah, now he's filled with the Holy Ghost. And he's going to do, and I'm going to continue this, Lord willing, next week. He's going to give immaculate praise. He's going to give praise that is just beautiful. He's going to give praise that just fills our minds. We're going to notice it just a little bit later on. Watch this. Let me just kind of interest you, your appetite for spiritual things. Look at verse 67. And his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Ghost, and he prophesied. He preached to all the people, saying, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people. I can't tell you how much preaching is right there, but we'll look at it a little bit later on, that he has visited us, and he visited us with a purpose in mind. He came to us to redeem us. But let's go back and underline that word, blessed. Listen to what he says. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel. How do we bless the Lord? What can we do to bless him? Underline this word, blessed, and notice what Zechariah was doing. Zechariah was actually saying, Lord, you are absolutely adorable. I don't know why I didn't get this right the first time. I had the incense mixed together. I had it in the censer of incense. I had fresh coals from the brazen altar of the tabernacle, the place of sacrifice in one hand. I had fresh hot coals from the place of sacrifice. In the other hand, I had the mixture from the stroax tree, the sweet gum. I had the frankincense. I had the myrrh. I was doing my duty. I was fulfilling every formality. I looked real religious as a priest in front of all of my contemporaries. But when I got before the altar of incense, I guess I was just thinking about just doing it legalistically or formally. I missed the angel of the Lord. And I didn't even respond to the angel of the Lord in the appropriate way. I would that everyone would just arrive one Sunday out of the year. I don't know which Sunday, just one Sunday. Sister Reisner and Brother Howard and everybody that leads in worship, and especially the pastor, I would that everybody would arrive just on one particular Sunday and everybody's ready to worship. And they said, this Sunday, I'm not going to mess up like I did last Sunday. Last Sunday, I just kind of sat there. Last Sunday, I was just a spectator. I wasn't a participant. I never wrote down any notes. I didn't take anything away from the message. Other people around me, they were saying, man, the message was good, and the worship was magnanimous, but I didn't get anything out of it. Matter of fact, my mind was somewhere else. And Zechariah would say, how could I put on all the priestly garb? How could I have it all in order? And I check my sash, and I make sure that the hem and the pomegranates and all that was hanging around the border of the skirt of my priestly robe, it was all in order. I had everything exactly where it was supposed to be. And then I got in there before God, and one of his chief messengers shows up, and I go to talking back to him in terms of doubt, in terms of skepticism. Instead of saying, yes, sir, you're the angel Gabriel, and I understand just how powerful you are. In the Old Testament, an angel tipped its wing and killed 180,000 Assyrians, and here's Zechariah talking back to him. I don't know about you. Before I leave this world, I'd like to get at least one worship experience in order with God. And God would say, that's a sweet-smelling savor in my nostrils. 141st Psalms at verse 2, what does he say? Let my prayer be set before thee as incense, and the lifting of my hands as the evening sacrifice. What if we all got ready this morning? You say, well, the snow distracted me. Well, there'll be something else next Sunday. Next Sunday, your stomach will be rumbling. Next Sunday, your nose will be dripping. Next Sunday, you and your wife is liable to have an argument. Next Sunday, your car may not start. Next Sunday, you might be exhausted at the end of the week. There's always going to be distractions to worship. There's always going to be hindrances to our praise. But the mature, spiritually minded Christian works on through that. I'm telling you, if I waited until the next time that I really felt like preaching, I may never preach again. And sometimes I really feel like preaching, and then I get up here and I look around and I say, oh my, what's wrong with them? And 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 that one's asleep, and that one's picking their nose, and that one's straightening up their clothes, and that one acts like they're bored to death, and this one seems to be miserable. And all of a sudden, I'm not instant in season and out of season because it's cold in here. Brr, there's no spirituality. There's no warmth whatsoever. And then sometimes you can just be riding down the road, and there's no church music, there's nothing going on, and you can just turn on the radio, and it might be a sermon from a preacher that's on our radio station, and all of a sudden it hits you, and you're lifting your hand, and you're praising God, and you're blessing His name. Would you save a little bit of that for next Sunday? Would you bring some of that with you? I can remember a time in this church that we could have a potluck supper, and it was wonderful, absolutely wonderful. There was a variety of meats, and there must have been 25 different casseroles of all kinds, even tuna fish casserole. I mean, there was all kinds of casseroles of every kind, and there was breads, and there was everything in the world. But now we're so busy, we can't even bake a cake. And now we're so busy, we stop by and get one of those store-bought deals and walk in there. We get rid of the box, we put it in an old cake pan and act like we made it up, and come in with pecan pie, and we act like, you know, a lot of love and care was put into this, and I made this at home. I hope nobody asked, so I don't have to lie right in the house of God that I really made this up. Would you next Sunday, would you mix something up and help me? Would you say, you know, preacher might be wore out. And preacher may have more on him than what he can stand, but he's trying to be faithful. He's been faithful for over 40 years, and he's trying to bring a good word to our heart, and I'm just kind of sitting here. I'm not cheering. I'm not helping. I'm not enthusiastic. I'm not involved in it. And God gives us another Sunday, and God gives us another opportunity. There's a lot of times I feel like Jeremiah. I'm never going to preach again. I'm done. I'm through. And what did Jeremiah say? There was a fire shut up in my bones, and I couldn't help but tell it all over again. And so he blesses the Lord. He says, Lord, you are absolutely adorable. You're the one that deserves all the praise. And in the midst of that blessing, it's not only adoration, but it's thanksgiving. You'd say, preacher, too late for that. We had a Thanksgiving Sunday. We counted our blessings. We named them one by one. There's a roof up above me. There's shoes on my feet. I've got food on the table and a warm place to sleep. That's done now, preacher. We're through with that. Every day for a child of God ought to be a day of giving the Lord thanks. That's the reason I fell in love with this precious man, Anir. He has just got a joy about him. He's got a thankful spirit about him. He's got beautiful daughters, and one of them about 12 years ago was hit by an automobile. His wife, high ranking in the Israeli police department, and when that child was hit, she retired. She resigned her position to do nothing but take care of that child. I was telling him about Boyd. They've been over the road of heartache and sorrow, but now she's getting ready to graduate law school. She's dating a handsome Israeli man, and Anir says, there's a wedding on the horizon. There's going to be a day of rejoicing. And he didn't know, for a little old spiritual Baptist, he's telling all that, but we're relating about children and what we're seeing them be able to do now after cancer, after being hit by a car, getting ready to graduate law school. There's a wedding on the horizon. And as we sat at the table last night, I said, oh my, look at Jesus. He resigned his position. He took himself away from glory. He laid his glory by. We had been hit by a car called sin. It had crippled us. We were handicapped. But he said, I'm going to give everything I've got to the reconciliation and the restoration of that child. And he came down from glory, and he came to us. And oh, I've got good news now. Jesus graduated law school. I've got an advocate with the Father that's seated at the right hand of the Father. My little children, these things I write unto you that you sin not. But if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. And I see a wedding on the horizon, and we're going to hear the call at the midnight hour. Behold, the bridegroom cometh, and the wedding chamber is going to be ready. And we're not going to be living near Emmaus. We're going to be living in the New Jerusalem and coming down from God out of heaven. And Jesus is going to reign from the throne of his father David forever and forever. Don't let me miss it, Lord. I say, bless your high and holy name, and I give you thanks for all that you have done. We have